Of the human voice, it's unmistakable. The human voice has fueled revolutions, inspired nations, it's caused global wars, and it has won them. The human voice has carried mankind to the moon. It's even shared a dream. In the business world, the power of the human voice has led teams to a level they would have never achieved otherwise. It's given great sales pitches. It's convinced board of directors. It's built industries where industries never existed. People will give of their lives and take others' lives because of words that they've heard. So what is it that makes some speakers and some speeches stand the test of time and others forgotten 5 minutes after they were given? More importantly, what inspires audiences of 1 to 100,000 or more to take immediate action based just on the words that they've heard? Ladies and gentlemen, it is indeed my honor to bring to you today Persuasive Speaking, How to Inspire People to Take Action. But before we begin, let me ask you a question. Who cares? Why do you care? Why should you care about this? Why do you want to be a more persuasive speaker? Well, you know, maybe it is something having to do with your job, your professional hobby, where you could better influence people. Maybe that would be a benefit to you. Or maybe it's just some hobby, something you'd like to see done in your community. Maybe something within your family. Maybe you'd like to see something progressing in your family. Maybe you'd just like your kids to brush their teeth or clean up their rooms. Or maybe it's bigger than that. See, I believe that every single person has had a thought at one point about a way that they might be able to change the world. Something they'd like to see change. Maybe it's just within their community. Maybe it's a cause they believe in, something that's special to them. Maybe it's a cause that would include the entire country. Maybe the entire world. But at some point, they decided that they couldn't have anything to do with it. That's just not for them. Maybe somebody else will do it. I'm going to ask you to do me a favor. I'm going to ask you right now, pull out a piece of paper or a keyboard, however you want to do it. But I'm going to ask you to do this. Make sure and do this for me. Let's not waste our time here, okay? Let's take some action. Pull out a piece of paper, and I want you to write down for me one or more things you would like to see change. You would like to see better. And again, it could be just something with your family, something in your community, something with the world. Take your time right now, and please write down at least one or more things. Don't watch me drink coffee. Come on, get at it. No, really, this coffee. Did you do it? Okay, fantastic. Thank you for doing that. I appreciate that. Now, I want you to look down at that list again for me, and I want you to ask yourself again, who cares? Who cares if those things happen or not? Will it really make a difference to you or to somebody you know or people you don't know? Would it really make a difference? Are those things really important to you? Are they? Would it be cool? Would it be amazing if they could happen? Got a secret for you. You actually have a superpower you don't know about yet. Or maybe you know about it, but it just hasn't been developed enough to actually make those things happen yet. You do have a superpower within you. You have the power of the human voice. Maybe it needs to be developed a little bit more. We'll do a lot of that today, but you already have it within you. But this comes with a warning, because every superpower has a kryptonite, right? Every superpower has this arch nemesis out there waiting to hold it back, waiting to counter it. And this is no exception. I'm about to play a very graphic image on this slide. I apologize to everybody watching. If you're squeamish, you may want to look away. Okay, graphic image warning. Because this image is more frightening to most of the population on the face of the earth than anything else. Okay, get ready. Look away if you're squeamish. Here we go. Ready? The microphone. I mean, it's amazing to me. This is the most frightening picture in the world to most of the population. You've already heard that the fear of death isn't as bad as the fear of public speaking to most people. That means that most people would rather look down the barrel of a shotgun than look down a microphone. Is that crazy? I love what Jerry Seinfeld says. He says, well, then at a funeral, most people would rather be in the coffin than giving the eulogy. And I've had a lot of people tell me, Terry, I can't speak passionately. I just can't do it. I don't have it in me. I'm here to tell you right now that you can speak passionately. If you question whether or not you can speak passionately, just ask your children. Raise your hand if you have spoken passionately to your children or somebody else's children before. Yes, absolutely. Now, and Eric, okay, somebody else's children. That works. Now, if you're still questioning whether you've spoken passionately, just ask your significant other. I believe that every single person has spoken passionately at one point in their life. Now, why is it you could speak passionately during those times, but question whether you can in front of an audience? Well, here's why. There's two reasons. Number one, because when you were speaking to your children, somebody else's children, one of your buddies, whatever it was, there was action they were going to take or stop taking immediately, right? And you also felt in command at that point. You were in charge. You felt powerful at that point. What if I could help you, show you how to become the most powerful you have ever been in your life at the drop of a hat? Bam, just like that. Bring all of that power, that strength back, just like that. Would that be cool? Would that be helpful? If your answer is yes, there you go. Let me tell you a story. Captain Scott was a buddy of mine in the United States Air Force. I met him at Squadron Officer School. Now, Squadron Officer School is a multi-week gig in the Air Force. It's the top captains in the Air Force get together, and they teach things, of course, warfighting ability, leadership, and listen, the power of the human voice, that's all about leadership, right? Inspiring others to take action. You want leadership? This is what it is. And public speaking was part of it. So it came time to the day one of the speaking day, and I went up, I gave my speech, no big deal, okay? Now, here comes Captain Scott. You need to understand something about Scott. This dude was hilarious, okay? This guy was so funny. You ever seen those people that have like a perma smirk on their face? Because they're always thinking of some smart aleck comment, you know? They've always got that devilish look at their eyes. Have you ever thought of some? You might be that person. Okay, well, that was Captain Scott. Funny, oh my gosh. So here we go. He's getting up to get his speech. I'm like, oh, here it comes, baby. Put your tray tables up. Put your seat backs in the upright position. Here comes Captain Scott. I noticed something about him as he was walking up there. He was carrying a stack of 3x5 cards. And there was something weird about those cards. They were possessed. How do I know? Because they were actually vibrating. In fact, Captain Scott was possessed as well, apparently, because he was shaking uncontrollably himself. Captain Scott was petrified. He was looking down at his feet as he shuffled up to the front of the room. He wasn't even speaking clearly. He was barely mumbling. Guys, he was so nervous. I was waiting for the little thing of pee to come down his flight suit. I mean it. He was scared. At one point, he finally just walked off. That's it. Like, oh my gosh. Well, Scott came up to me outside of the barracks tonight. He said, Terry, can you help me? I said, well, yeah, I probably can. I spent 15 minutes with Scott. 15 minutes. That's it. 3 days later, it's time for round two. Oh no, here we go, it's Scott's turn. I don't know, guys, I don't know. I noticed something about him this time too. Only one 3x5 card. And that 3x5 card, that is not shaking at all. That sucker is rock solid, and so is Captain Scott. He's got that smirk again on his face. He's got that look in his eyes of confidence. He is looking everybody in the eyes. He gets up there, guys. He does not only finish the speech, but he nails it. He is fantastic. He moves that audience. It was amazing. So let me ask you, would you be interested in hearing what I told Scott? If so, let's get into it. Okay, first of all, Scott, of course, wanted to know how to be an amazing speaker. Now, we're going to talk today about three pillars. You're going to want to write these down and put some space in between. Even if you're already an amazing speaker, well, this might give you some ideas to hone those even more or to teach other people. So you're going to want to write this down. Number one is motivation. Number two, preparation. And number three, presentation. Motivation, preparation, and presentation. So let's get into the first one right here. I said, Scott, I got some great news for you. We're going to take the pressure off completely. He goes, well, good. How are you going to do that? It's not about you. It's not about you. The speech has nothing to do with you, man. Well, of course it does. I'm up front. All the eyes are on me. All the pressure's on me. No, it's not. It's not about you. We're going to change that mindset right now. If we can switch this mindset, we're going to change your life, my friend. It's not about you. Listen, it's about the cause. It's about the reason you're up there, the thing you want to impart upon them, get them believing in. That's what it's all about. And listen, all of us will fight for a cause. Is that right? And if you're fighting for a cause, you don't care about what people think about you. If I'm fighting for a cause, look, don't worry about me. You hate me? You think I'm a butthead? I don't care. It's not about me. It's about those kids. It's about those people. It's about the animals. It's about humanity. It's about what's really important. It's about the cause. And if you will shift to that mindset, it's not about you, then it's not about how to be an amazing speaker at all. It has nothing to do with that. It never did. It's about inspiring people to take action. That's what it's all about. And that takes the pressure off, because now instead of going up there worrying about, I've got to give a speech, I've got to be dynamic, now it's, this is my chance to make a difference. I believe in this cause. I believe in what I'm about to talk about. It might be your product or your service if you're in sales. It might be something you want your team to do in leadership, in business or otherwise. Whatever it is, it's about your chance to make a difference with that team. That's what it's all about. So what did I do with Captain Scott that night outside the barracks at the Air Force Base? I asked him a question. That's all I did. I asked him a question. I said, Scott, when is the most powerful you've ever been in your life? And Scott's going, wait, what? When is the most powerful you've ever been in your life? Well, I don't know. Well, think of it. Think about the time. Well, it took a little bit of time. He said, well, I can think of a few, I guess, you know, maybe. The human psyche is an amazing thing, isn't it? If I were to ask you, when is the most embarrassed you have ever been in your life? You'd be able to go, bam, I got the answer. If I were to ask you, when is the worst you have ever felt? What's the worst moment of your entire life? Bam, you'd have an answer just like that, right? But I ask you about the most powerful time, and it takes, I worked with people literally in different parts of the world with this, and it's universal. For most people, it takes them a while to come up with the one thing that made them feel the best, the most powerful, the most in control, the most, So I kept working with Scott. Scott, keep working on that. And he'd say a couple, and I don't think that's it, because I didn't see it in his eyes. And then he started thinking. And that perma smirk started coming back on Scott's face. And that fire started coming back as a spark in his eyes. And I said, Scott, that's it. You've got it. Tell me about it. Now, understand something. Scott was an electronics warfare officer on the nuclear-equipped B-52 aircraft. Each nuclear-equipped B-52 bomber, fully loaded, is approximately the sixth most powerful nation on the face of the earth. Scott has seen some things. He's done some things. He's been there, okay? Guess what Scott's most powerful time ever was? Guess for a second. A softball game. Yeah, a softball game. That's it. A softball game. Really? Yeah, I hit a home run. All right, cool. No, you don't get it, Terry. I hit the game-winning home run. Like, oh, that's different. Okay, now I'm starting to get, tell me more about that. So what happened? It left the bat. Did you know it? Oh, I knew it right away, man. It was solid. There it's flying. I'm watching it fly. I'm going, oh my God, it's going out. It's fantastic. And then tell me, you're running the bases. Oh yeah, first base, man. Bam, high five. Second base, high five. You're coming into home base. What happens? They're all there. The whole team's waiting for me. They're cheering. I can barely get to the base because everybody's hugging me. It's a dog pile on Scott. Scott, how do you feel right now? I feel fantastic. Scott, this is what I want you to do. Before you speak 3 days from now, I want you to take the time. Forget about what's going on in the room. Don't even be in the room. Be on that softball field. I want you to be thinking about that. I want you to be seeing it, feeling it, hearing it, smelling it. I want you to get that feeling again that you've got right now. Can you do that for me? Absolutely. I think I can do that. See, when Scott went up that second time, it wasn't about him. And it wasn't about worrying about how good he's going to do on his speech. Scott, the guy that went up there at that point, was the guy that just hit that home run. Now, I want you, you've probably already been doing it, and I hope you have. I want you to be thinking about, what is that time for you? Now, when I'm doing these in person, sometimes we'll have a chance to work with people on that. We're not going to have that time today, but I want you to take the time. This is all important when it comes to persuading an audience, okay? It's all important that you are feeling the most powerful you ever have. Work with somebody else, be it on the telephone, Zoom conference, whatever it might be. Ask them the questions. Pull them back in. Get excited with them. And then learn to harness that. Listen, I do it every single time. I did it right before this today. I do it before any sales call, before any time I'm getting up to do an acting job, before I get into that state. I've got to feel powerful before I can do that. It works if you'll do it. Now I'm going to show you another clip right now, another speaking clip. And I want you to think about the things that we've talked about so far while you're watching this and see if JFK does these exact same things.
We choose to go to the moon. We choose to go to the moon. We choose to go to the moon in this decade and do the other things. not because they are easy, but because they are hard. We set sail on this new sea because there is new knowledge to be gained and new rights to be won. And they must be won and used for the progress of all mankind. We shall send to the moon 240,000 miles away from the control station in Houston, a giant rocket more than 300 feet tall, made of new metal alloys, some of which have not yet been invented, capable of standing heat and stresses, several times more than have ever been experienced, fitted together with a precision better than the finest watch, carrying all the equipment needed for propulsion, guidance, control, communications, food, and survival, on an untried mission to an unknown celestial body. And therefore, as we set sail, we ask God's blessing on the most hazardous and dangerous and greatest adventure on which man has ever embarked. Thank you.
It was impossible. Not improbable, it was impossible. The alloys hadn't even been invented yet. But did that stop him from using his superpower, the power of the human voice, to persuade people to take action? Because of that belief, he made it happen. He made other people believe it could happen as well, and they did it. See, if you've got the motivation in place, quite honestly, the rest of it falls into place. You've done it before. You've spoken passionately before. Then you say, wait a minute, but this is for more of a professional audience, perhaps. Okay, let's talk about that. That's going to take some preparation. Now, if you recall, the last two pillars here were preparation and presentation. And a lot of people think it's all about the presentation. That's what they focus on. How can I be a better speaker? I've even had people tell me that they have watched online. They have focused on speakers online to watch what they're doing so they could mimic them. And they've spent hours doing it. I said, man, if you spent hours doing that, you have wasted hours of time. Because it's not about that. Will fall into place. Spend that time doing proper preparation. Now, how do you prepare a presentation? It could be a short one. It could be a sales pitch. It could be for just inspiring your team or full-blown talk, okay? How do you put one of those together that inspires people to take action? Well, first of all, understand 90% of it is in the preparation. 10% is in the presentation. Focus your time where it needs to be. Start with the end in mind. Start with the end in mind. This is critical. Listen. What action do you want the audience to take? What do you want them to do? What is it you're trying to impart upon them? That one singular idea, not all of them. If you notice, an audience will take away one thing. That's it. All those words you worried about or you wanted to get exactly right, they're not going to remember any of them. They're going to remember one thing. When you're listening to Martin Luther King, you know he had a dream. You don't remember the subtleties of it, but he had a dream. You know that. JFK said, we're going to go to the moon. You don't remember the rest of it, but you remember that one thing. As you're crafting your speech, your talk, whatever it is, it's all about that one thing. If it's not, it's out of there. There are no by the ways. Oh, by the way, no, it's out of there. Because listen, if it doesn't add, it detracts. That's critical. If it doesn't add, it detracts. Start with the end in mind and stick to that. Now, there's a format we've all heard about in speaking. Okay, introduction, body, and conclusion. Okay, and there's a reason that that's what we've all heard about. You know, introduce your topic, tell them what you're going to tell them, tell them what you told them, you know, and that's great. And if you do it this way, you'll bore the crap out of them, man. Sorry, but you will. You need to enhance it better than that. That's why some speeches stand the test of time and others don't. Would it be helpful to you if we were to break each one of these down and give you some ideas to make them far more impactful, would it? All right, then let's keep going. If not, you're already checking email anyway. So what, you think I can't see you? No, I can't see you, but it's amazing. Several people just went, oh crap. All right, let's jump into the introduction part. How do you make an introduction that makes them want to hear you? That they can't wait to hear what you've got to say, that you own them? Okay, first of all, you got to answer this question. Why should I care? Why do I want to listen to you? Why do I want to sit here for a half an hour or an hour or whatever it is? Why should I care? Now, how do you do that? How do you get into their subconscious screaming for the information that you've got to tell them? Well, first of all, make them feel emotion. Emotion governs all of our actions. Emotion governs all of our actions. Our desire to learn, our desire to take action, everything. It's all about emotion. You need to create emotion in your audience. One way to do it is by telling a story. We're going to talk a lot more about stories in just a few minutes here. It's critical. And a lot of people will start their speech with a story. I started with a whole lot of people's stories speaking today. And then I told you about Scott Yvonne to bring you in and create some emotion of, man, I want to know that information, hopefully. Problem solution format is very powerful. Create a problem. People hate that discord in their mind. They hate that discord in their life. They want a solution to a problem. If you watch the way movies are crafted, they get you to care about the audience, care about the people on there, and then a problem comes up with them. And you're like, oh, no, no, that can't happen. Something's got to resolve itself. Problem solution format. That's a way to do a speech introduction as well. It gets the audience wanting to know the information. Let's listen to how one of the, in my opinion, best people who's ever walked this earth started one of her speeches.
I personally am most unworthy, but I brought a girl child from the street, and I could see in the face of the child, as the child was hungry. God knows how many days they had not eaten. So I gave her a piece of bread. But the little one started eating the bread crumb by crumb. And I said to the child, eat the bread. Eat the bread. And she looked at me and said, I'm afraid to eat the bread because I'm afraid when it is finished, I will be hungry again.
If that doesn't get you wanting to hear more, if that doesn't get emotions going on, you don't have a heartbeat, man. Mother Teresa came from nothing. She had nothing. And yet she used her superpower, the power of the human voice, to inspire the world. She also can start off a speech pretty well, too. And you notice it wasn't about her. It was about her cause and creating that emotion that made people want the information. She gave the problem that we want to see the solution for. Now, the next part of this is the body. Now, here's the thing, though. Here's the problem. You've got them eating out of your hands. They can't wait to hear what you've got to say. They are psyched up. Tell me more. Tell me more. You have to deliver, right? The question is, how do you do so, one, in an interesting manner, and two, in a way that gets them to want to take action? Well, let's get just a very quick hint from a pretty smart guy, Steve Jobs. Just a quick hint to what he does.
Truth be told, I never graduated from college. And this is the closest I've ever gotten to a college graduation. Today, I want to tell you three stories from my life. That's it. No big deal. Just three stories.
That's it. No big deal, but three stories. Now, stories are critical. We're really going to hit on that. But you notice, first of all, in the body, he talks about, let's go, there we go. In the body of the speech, often three main points. You've probably heard that. Often three main points, because that can get convoluted if you go more. But listen, rules are meant to be broken, okay? If you've got one strong point, that's all that matters, man. One point that will inspire them to take action, roll with it. The important thing is, though, you keep repeating your main theme throughout. Bring it back in, that one thing you started with, that one thing you got them excited about, that you created the problem with. You've got to bring that back in. Keep reminding them, keep reminding them. And again, tell stories. That's so important. I want to go into that more right now. It's important to know that facts tell, stories sell. Facts tell, stories sell. If you want to inform an audience, show them numbers and graphs and little bar graphs and pie graphs and charts and crap like that. If you want to inspire them, forget it all, because they will tell stories. You want to paint pictures. We think in pictures. If I tell you about I've got my old golden retriever there. Now he's getting white in the face, but he's still got a lot of speed. He's always smiling. You know, in fact, he's got his favorite ball, his tail's wagging right now, and he can't wait till I get done so we can play with him for the ball. Do you picture a golden retriever in your head right now? Probably. You don't picture the words golden retriever. No, we think in pictures. Tell similes, tell metaphors. Jesus was pretty good at this, and he spoke in parables. He painted pictures. Right now, for those who are watching the recording of this, we're in the middle of the pandemic. I live in Washington State, and our governor has been starting to talk about opening up the state. And he's not doing about, we're going to do a staggered progression of blah, 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 blah. No. He did this. Listen, this is brilliant. It's not going to be like flipping a switch. It's going to be like turning a dial. Everybody gets it. Just like that. Paint pictures for people and bring out emotions. People do not act on fact. They act on emotion. If people are emotional enough, they will literally do anything. They will give up their lives. They will take others' lives because of the emotion that has been given to them. Create emotion if you want people to take action and watch what happens. You know, somebody that was pretty good at creating emotion, Dr. Martin Luther King. We saw a short excerpt earlier from this speech, but I want you to watch it again and more of it and be looking at everything we've talked about so far and see how he puts this into action.
I have a dream that one day on the red hills of Georgia, the sons of former slaves and the sons of former slave owners will they be able to sit down together at the table of brotherhood. I have a dream that one day, even the state of Mississippi, a state sweltering with the people's injustice, sweltering with the heat of oppression, will be transformed into an oasis of freedom and justice. I have a dream. My four little children will one day live in a nation where they will not be judged by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. I have a dream today.
He had a dream. He's the son of a preacher. That's who he is. We all get in our mind, we're not good enough to make things happen. We don't have the background. This man had a dream. He used the power of the human voice and changed the world. So now, how do you conclude? How do you conclude in a way that makes them want to take the action you're looking for them to take? See, this is a critical part, because this is the feeling that they're left with at the end of your talk. Have you ever been to a movie or watched a movie, and it's a pretty good movie, and then all of a sudden it just stops? It just ends, and you're like, wait, what? That was it? Have you ever seen that? I think a lot of us have. And I liken it to a football game. And he catches it on the 50-yard line, 40, 30, 20, 10, 5-yard line, fumble! You do all this work, you do all these amazing things, and it comes down to the end, and fumble the speech. Well, there are some things here, too, to leave them where you want them to take action. And the first one is end on a high note, baby. That is the feeling they're going to have when they walk out of the room, when they walk out and go to take the action you want them to take. You've got to leave them on a high note. You've started them off, hopefully, with presenting the problem. You've got the solution. Now they feel like they can actually conquer it. They can make it happen. You want to bring your main theme back into it. Bring what you started with back around to the end. Make sure that you wrap it all together so they know exactly how it all ties in together. And then do the call to action. Tell them what you want them to do. Make sure they understand. Remind them to get out there and do it right now. That's how you can conclude a speech, to get people to take the action you want them to take. Now, let's watch a very precarious situation. For those that weren't alive back then, the Berlin Wall stood for many, many years separating a society. One man, President Ronald Reagan, stood up to it, stood up to Mikhail Gorbachev, and told him to tear down this wall. This is the conclusion of that speech. And let's see if he leaves it on a high note, if the audience knows when to clap, and if action gets taken.
As I looked out a moment ago from the Reichstag, that embodiment of German unity, I noticed words crudely spray-painted upon the wall, perhaps by a young Berliner. Quote, "This wall will fall, beliefs become reality." Yes, across Europe this wall will fall, for it cannot withstand faith, it cannot withstand truth. The wall cannot withstand freedom. And I would like, before I close, to say one word. I have read and I have been questioned since I've been here about certain demonstrations against my coming. And I would like to say just one thing, and to those who demonstrate so. I wonder if they have ever asked themselves that if they should have the kind of government they apparently seek, no one would ever be able to do what they're doing again. Thank you, and God bless you all.
Now, that's how you end a speech, to inspire people to take action. And the wall came down. So that's the preparation part. If you put the time into that preparation, the last part, guys, honestly, this is easy. I'm going to have a couple of quick hints for you, but that's all, because that's all you're going to need to put the final hone on the blade. That's it. Because if you've got the inspiration and the preparation, the motivation, the preparation, you've got this, right? You've got this, and nobody can stop you. For some quick little presentation hints, rev up your speech. Now, rev is an acronym. What does that mean? First of all, change the rate of delivery. If you've noticed, some of the times here, I'm talking and I'm going really fast. Other times, listen, other times I'm going slowly. That resets the attention span. That resets the attention span. It gets people to go, wait, what? Wait, what? And that's what you want to do throughout there. Don't overdo any of this, but do that and it'll keep them coming back. Next, eye contact is critical. Now, I know there's some speaking coaches out there that perhaps have told you, look above the audience. Bull, absolutely not. You want to convince the audience and you want them to take action, right? You better be looking them in the eyes. And you want every single person in that audience to think that you are talking to them. Listen, the eyes are the windows to the soul, right? You want to touch their soul. You want to get that emotion going so they take the action. Look them in the eyes, folks. And the final one, volume. Volume. Change your volume around. Because if you really want to get an audience's attention, whisper. Whisper. And you'll own the room. So that's it, folks. That's it. That's how to inspire people to take action. You now can do it. You know about the motivational aspect to it. It's not about you. It's about the message. And if you feel strongly enough about your message, you will be fantastic. And you now know how to be the most powerful you've ever been in your life. You bring those two forces together and you're unstoppable. Now to craft that talk, you know to start with the end in mind and everything goes right around there. When you structure your speech, you now know those three different aspects and how to nail them. And it's all about telling stories to create that emotion that drives people to action. And the last thing, the presentation, the easy part, rev it up, have fun. And if you've done the rest of it, you will have fun. I'm going to ask y'all for one more favor before we close. Look back at that list you made. If you didn't make it, shame on you. Make it. Look back at that list. Are those things important to you? Are they? At least one of them. Is that important? I want you to think about one of them on there. Is that important to you that that happens? What does it matter? Who does it affect? What if I could tell you, without question, you have the superpower within you to make it happen. It doesn't matter what your background is. It doesn't matter how you feel about yourself or how others feel about you. You have the superpower of the human voice within you to make anything happen. You've seen people who have done it. It may not be easy. It may be hard. But the power of the human voice is the most powerful force on this planet or any other. It's inspired nations. It's inspired the entire world. It may not be easy. Sometimes those self-doubts may still creep in. The fear may try to come back, but you won't let it. You may wonder if people are listening, and sometimes it won't feel like they are, and maybe they're not. But I'd like to leave you with one last thought before we close this segment for today. JFK believed that one person can make a difference, and that every person should try. Ladies and gentlemen, use your voice, your superpower, to change the world. Thank you.
That was awesome, Terry.
Thanks, Richard.
Judging by all the messages that are coming in, everybody seems to be feeling the same way. I'm ready to go to the home run, brother. Woo!
Thank you, guys. I appreciate that very much. Appreciate that.
Sorry, I've got like these guys doing yard work out in front. So if you hear something, don't mind me. But some questions are starting to come in now. Let's see here. I'm going to actually, so I can get off because it's quite loud. I want, let's see, Iswan, if you'd like to chime in, you can unmute yourself and ask your question.
Hi, Terry, can you hear me?
I can hear you.
Terry, amazing talk, by the way. I really enjoyed it.
Oh, thank you. I appreciate that.
Yeah, okay. I have a question. I mean, you showed some really, really good examples of world leaders and giving speeches and all their talks and how they've inspired and captured the, you know, attentions and of many, you know, millions of people, I guess. My question is, do you see the way that this message has been delivered changes over, you know, the last few decades, right? I mean, the way how Kennedy talks compared to the leadership that we have right now. I mean, both have been able to capture the attentions and, you know, also inspire millions of people. But I have to say, you know, their methods can't be, you know, more different.
Isn't it the truth? Yeah, thank you for that. That's a fantastic question. I appreciate you bringing it up. And that really proves my point that it's not about the presentation so much. Because what I can tell you is the motivation part, it was the same. It wasn't about them. You notice many of them started with, it's not about me. You know, or I've never been to college, but it was all about their cause. And it's about creating that emotion, telling the stories. That hasn't changed over the years. That's always the most powerful thing. And those people felt powerful within themselves already. Now, I work with people a lot that don't feel, they're not in those positions already, as perhaps Martin Luther King wasn't to begin with. So being able to develop that strength that people already have with them, within them, and get them to harness that and bring them out, that's the powerful piece. The motivation, preparation is always a truism. The more you prepare, the harder you work, the more successful you are. Now, so the semantics might change. You know, my style is completely different than somebody else's style. Outstanding. It's not about that. It's really all about the first two parts, and the third will fall into place. Does that make sense?
Yeah, good. Thanks.
Okay, you bet. Thanks for asking. I appreciate it.
Hey, Terry, Dave O'Connor, how you doing?
Howdy, amazing. How about yourself, Dave?
I'm doing good. Okay.
Hey, the quick question is that as we're going into the modern technology here, and we're all working from home these days, you talk about eye contact. How do I fall in love with the camera, somebody who hasn't done a lot of camera work in the past, and have that eye contact, and I'm trying to do it with my voice, which I think I do well with that. But how do I engage that person on the other side of the camera?
Good, fantastic. Thanks for asking that, Dave. And I work with people on camera work as well, the same thing. It's kind of difficult for some people during these Zoom meetings, because if you see I'm looking at you right now, right?
Yes.
Yeah, I'm looking at you right now. I'm not looking at your picture down here. Here's where you're at on my screen. That's not what I'm looking at. I'm looking at you. In fact, I'm not looking at the camera right here. I'm looking past the camera.
Okay. I
have in my mind that you're back there. I'm looking at you through that camera. That's the deal, is projecting yourself through the camera. If you're ever doing actually on camera work, I teach people, do not look at the lens. Look past the lens at the people. And that's how you project yourself through this technology and still be pretty powerful. Thanks for asking. Did that help, Dave? Did that answer?
Yep. You're teaching an old dog new tricks.
I understand, my friend.
Hey, Terry, would you mind just stop like sharing the screen so that everyone can see you a bit better?
Oh, I'm sorry.
No worries. If you don't need it, just, you know, they'd like to see you and so forth. Eric Covington has a question for you, Terry.
I'm trying to talk about old dogs, new tricks. I'm going, okay, how do I share my screen again? There it is. New share. Let's see if that works. Now it's going to show my desktop. Is that okay? And you'll take it from there, Richard. Is that right?
I think you want to unshare.
I think if you hit share screen again, it should just automatically not share it.
Okay, new share.
Sarah, are you able to do that for him?
No, it doesn't appear that I can do that for him. I believe he will have to.
That's right. I'm not pretty.
Just stop sharing. Just stop sharing, Terry. That will do it. Okay.
Stop sharing? Okay, yep. I just did a pin video. Okay. If I stop video, I know that'll stop. Why don't I stop my video and start it again? Let's try that.
No, the video won't do it. It's your it's sharing your screen. Just hit the green button at the bottom that says sharing, and it will say stop.
The other thing, Richard, I'm going to try to share my screen real quick because it will stop his.
Okay.
And then I will stop sharing my screen, and then I think we'll be back.
There we go.
Okay. Are we back to me, or am I still trying to figure it out?
I think we're good now.
We're good.
Good.
Yes. Okay. Hi.
Good. There you go.
Okay, so Eric had a question for you.
Yes, Eric.
Yeah, my question for you, I don't know if you've heard of I'm sure you have heard of this, actually. The golden circle rule, kind of like when you're talking about an idea, reversing it and how you would normally go about it to make an audience think about it. And I have a second kind of part of my question. I noticed a lot of things about great speakers like Martin Luther King Jr. and especially Martin Luther King Jr. is the one that immediately comes to my head, is the fluctuation in their voice. And I know what the word is called, but in some languages, words mean different things depending on your tone. And English isn't technically one of those languages, but I feel like you can apply so much meaning by what you say that. So what is the best way that, you know, when do you change tones? How do you move your emphasis on that?
Yeah, you bet. And first of all, a lot of us will have a lot of different rules out there. Rules are meant to be broken. There's a lot of different techniques, different things that different people do. But I don't worry about where am I going to drop my voice. I'm going to go and liken this to acting also. Now, there's certain technique in acting that we do, but a lot of it is just believe it. Believe you are that person in that situation, reacting appropriately. And if you can get yourself in that situation, you'll act appropriately. I play a little bit of piano, and I don't know how. I don't know. I can't read music or anything like that. And I had a music teacher, actually my sister-in-law, say, oh my God, he knows exactly when to bring it quiet, when to make it louder and all that. I'm like, no, I don't. I feel it. So to me, don't worry again so much about the semantics. Now, try to vary your voice in there, figure out times, be it volume and speed and all that, you betcha. But most of it should come to the heart. From the heart, because people can tell if you're speaking from the heart or if you're just some sort of a practiced machine up there. Speak from the heart. Does that help, Eric? Does that make sense? Okay, good. Thanks, buddy. I appreciate it.
Do we have any more questions for Terry, or would you like for him to go ahead and kind of delve in a little bit into the kicking and screaming and some of the other fun stuff that that he's doing and has done? Eric's got another question.
All right, Eric, go for it, buddy.
Sorry, one more thing.
Not at all.
This is actually like a one thing I want to mention about the kicking and screaming thing is that I forget her name, but I watched her a couple times on Twitch, and I was like, oh, I know her. And I was like, oh, it's a scout. I was like, this is going to be funny. that made me laugh. So I enjoyed watching the entire thing. I watched with my mom. We talked about it at the troop meeting, and that was really inspirational. It's not inspirational, but it was inspirational at points, working with somebody who you didn't expect to have that work out. One thing I wanted to ask you about was when you go to speak, when you're up there, do you with the audience? Do you my grandfather was talking about this? Do you look like? Do you ever go around and kind of like try to get at each eye, or do you kind of try to look? Like you're talking about this camera kind of a little bit past it. What is and also with your voice, I know that it's not hard to set rules and you're just kind of predictive if you're a heart wake, what you're doing like that. Do you use your diaphragm, kind of project like some of the higher speakers do, or do you usually just use your regular voice?
I'm using it mic'd up, so it's my usual voice to say that. Now, as far as going around the room, you bet I do. In fact, I'm that guy, and I don't remember if I did it at the speeches you were at or not, but it can be a crowd of a few thousand people, and I will jump off the stage, and I will walk to the back of the room. Or by God, I love doing this, a few hundred people, whatever, because people freak out. Because in the back is tough, man. It's hard to project to the back of the room, you know, and it's hard for them to get the energy when they're way back there. So I'll walk back there. And it's so funny because you see them go, they can't believe that the speaker is walking back to the back of the room and talking to them. And I love walking throughout the crowd if it's appropriate to do so. And because that keeps their attention. That is another one of my tricks. If I'm walking over here now they're looking at me there. Now I'm walking over here. So it does keep their attention. But it's all, again, it's not real scripted. It's I've worked it so hard and I've practiced so much. I practice, guys, out loud. This is critical. Out loud. So this is the first time, by the way, I've given this speech to the public. But not the first time I've given it. My dog can give the speech right now because he heard it so many times. Practice. That way I can have fun with the audience. I can walk out there. I can do the things and mess with them. I'll mess with the people at the front of the room. And the people at the back of the room think it's great. So you betcha, I'm all over the place given the opportunity. I don't even stand behind a podium. It doesn't happen.
We get two more questions and then maybe we can pivot to the kicking and screaming.
You want to do that, don't you, Richard?
I absolutely do, because I know everyone's going to be blown away because it's very interesting, it's very fun, and so forth. But without further ado, I believe Lorena Lawrence has a question, and then Bree Pample.
Hi, Terry. Thank you. Hey, hi there. I have a question. Early during when you started the call, you said you asked us to write down our dreams or three things that are important to us, and yes. Then at the end of the presentation, you told us, don't worry about your background. Don't worry how you feel about yourself. You have a dream, follow it. Can you tell us more about it? And what does that mean to you?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. Yeah. And Eric has kind of heard this story before. You guys know that my brother, Mike Fossum, is listening into the call. He's a former astronaut, currently the vice president over Texas A&M University Galveston campus. You've learned a little bit about me now, and our third brother, I'd say, is the best of all of us. He's this amazing, amazing, giving, philanthropic guy that keeps the family together while Mike and I are off doing crazy stuff. He keeps the family together, Greg. Oh, by the way, we were born in the poorest city in the United States of America, McAllen, Texas. A lot of y'all might know where it's at. McAllen, Texas is the poorest city in the United States of America. We're surrounded by gangs and drugs. Listen. I was on the wrong end of an assault rifle in middle school, in junior high, in my own back alley. When I was in high school, our father was killed. Before he died, one of the neighbors came up to him and said, I just want to make sure you understand something. Not a single one of your boys, he said this to my father, not a single one of your three sons will ever grow up to be anything. Yeah, you know what? We kind of believe differently. We kind of believe that it doesn't matter where you come from, and we're not the only people. We're just one of millions of stories just like that out there. No, it doesn't come. It doesn't matter where you come from, what's happened to you, what's been done to you. None of those things matter. That's in the past. You worry about your future. And with the power of the human voice and with your full belief and the grace of God behind you, you can accomplish great things. There's no doubt in my mind. Is that helpful, Lorena?
Yeah, thank you very much.
Okay, you got it.
Bree, and then we actually do have one more too. Bree?
Okay. So at the beginning, you spoke about, you know, finding the change that you want to see in the world. I'm curious about balancing the signal versus the noise, you know, and should you be quiet at first and then, you know, crescendo into I'm not sure how that works, but you know, would it be advantageous to just jump right in and start talking about it? You know,
of course, that is a whole different presentation, which is great. I am not known for my subtlety. perhaps none of us are. Bull in a china shop might come in handy, you know. But to me, man, just use your voice. There's a story, and I'm I would prepared for it completely, but the battle of, final battle, naval battle, Tecumseh. Okay, let me go back. I'm gonna mess this up completely, but that's okay. Final naval battle of the Civil War. And it was Mobile Bay going into attack, but it was protected by, I think, two forts and torpedoes. Now, torpedoes back then were what we call mines, okay? So what the admiral did is he lashed two ships together to go into attack. So if one is hit, the other one would hopefully keep it afloat. And as they started going into the attack, sure enough, the worst happened. One of them got hit by a mine and actually sunk immediately. You've got all these guns blaring at you. You've got the fog of war. You've got literally the fog of the gunpowder, the gunfire and everything going on. The men are petrified. They stop in their tracks. They don't go any further. Admiral Faraday climbs up above the fog and screams out to all of them, "Damn the torpedoes, full speed ahead. Damn the torpedoes, full speed ahead." You know what? There's going to be landmines everywhere we go. There's going to be people trying to take us down, especially with the internet these days. There are haters everywhere. Damn the torpedoes, full speed ahead. Use your voice.
Thank you.
Thanks. Hopefully that was helpful.
Fernando Lopez, please.
Hey, Terry. Sorry for the outlook, actually. I was just running while you were presenting. So,
nice.
Can you hear me okay?
Yeah, I can. It's a lot of echo, but we can hear you.
Okay, so, I love what you said about the passion. And my question is, you know, how much passion, how much the end goal, how much speaking from the heart versus the preparation? You know, at times in my particular case, when I talk from the heart without preparing anything, without just letting it go, you know, I've done much better than preparing a script and trying to memorize, you know, and in fact, I hate that. So anyway, that's the question.
Okay, absolutely. I appreciate that question. And I'm going to give you Terry's opinion on it, okay? So take it or leave it. I'm the guy with the microphone, so I'll give my opinion, but feel free to completely throw it away. And I've had people tell me, well, I prefer to talk off the cuff. Now, I'm a preparer, baby. I'm a preparer. When I, like I said, this speech, I took a long time to write and pull things out because they weren't exactly on topic and, you know, to really make it the words that I wanted, and then a practice. So when I get up there, I don't have to worry about nerves. I don't have to worry about that. And I've done the work to where I'm going to get the result that I want, God willing. I'm going to get the result that I want. To me, prepare. Put the time in. Some people are gifted. They can just stand up there, and by God, they can do all that without work. You know what? I'm not that guy, all right? And a lot of people are not. If you are, fantastic, man. You got this. Most people aren't. Just like in everything, it's all about hard work. As I'm sitting here going through God knows how many videos, hours of videos, to try to find the right videos to go in there. And I got so many other projects also going on. I'm just sitting here thinking, it's all about the hard work, man. Success is all about hard work.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Oh, you betcha, Fernando. You betcha.
Good advice, Terry. One last question. Eric has one more question, and then we're gonna move on. I'm destined to see it.
Sorry about this. I asked a lot of questions, but I kind of wanted to ask one thing, kind of say one thing. One thing I noticed, I think I'm the only like really young person. I'm 17. Here, and what I notice when I talk to a lot of adults, I try to do a lot of things. I'm part of the Scouting Honor Society or the Arrow, and we do a lot of leadership activity and stuff like that, which Mr. Fossum is also part of, both of them. That one thing I always notice, especially in business adults or anything like that, is the older you seem to get, the more afraid I think people are of answering questions, butting in, and potentially losing their status or risking it. When you think like a kid, they say what they mean. They get it out there. They like do it. And it, sometimes it's stupid. And sometimes it's like, whoa, that's actually like really good. You know what I mean? And so I think it's personally, I would ask you, how important do you think it is just to be brave and just do what you're going to say sometimes? Because that's what a kid does. And often I'm always shocked by what I see some younger kids say something that I would never thought of. Yeah.
I'm sure everybody's heard this. Bravery is not the absence of fear. It's acting in spite of fear. And to me, if you are talking about something you believe in so much, you truly believe it in your being, that fear will go away. Because again, it's not about you. It's about the cause. I've got some causes I really believe in. And you'll see, and we'll see on this show clip that we're going to do, Richard, people made fun of me. They made, because I represented all of Boy Scouts of America on this show. And I had a guy making fun of me on there. Okay, fine. I don't care what you think. I care what I think and what I believe in. So how's that for a transition into the show, Richard? And you're muted, buddy.
I know. Sorry. No, it's actually a great transition. But actually, Scott actually wanted to ask something that he also thought was going to be a great transition into it as well. So go ahead, Scott.
So this is directed to Fernando, and Fernando's question, I think it addresses what Terry stated, and I've met Terry a couple times and probably seen every episode of Kicking and Screaming at least a dozen times or more. Okay. I'm very much into the detail of some of the nuances of things. And I would say, Fernando, there's a lot of people that can speak from the cuff. There's a lot of people with a lot of confidence in speaking. There are a lot of people that can really do things off the cuff on that show. And they were very skilled at what they did, and they thought that they could do, anything impromptu that would win that show and make the Boy Scout look like a fool. But in the end, there was one on the show that was prepared.
And in truth, I worked hard to be prepared. I went down to the Amazon jungle and did survival when it looked like I might be on the show. Flew across the country, met with different experts, learned as much as I could. I did. I even went into a personal trainer and said, all right, you've got 4 weeks. Can you do it? And he looked at me and went, can you?
Be prepared.
Right on, man.
That's awesome. Thanks, Scott. Okay, my friend. Terry, floor is yours again.
All right, let's pull up.
Do you want to give them just like a minute of like kind of background?
Yeah, I certainly will. Can you show my slides again here so I can show the video or no?
You should be able to just hit share screen again.
Okay, let me do this. I'll do that even before. Okay, share screen. Good. Are y'all seeing my messy desktop?
No, we've got your PowerPoint background. Yeah.
Okay, good. Okay, you're seeing the Kicking and Screaming right now?
Yes, sir.
Okay, good. Okay, so a little bit of build up to this. I had no desire to be on a survival reality show. Zero, none. Have you seen what they make them eat? In fact, I'd always said I will never be on one of those because I don't want to eat disgusting things. Now, I married into 3 teenage and preteen boys just a little over 10 years ago. And when I did so, I retired from business. I called up my partners and said, I'll maybe talk to you in a few years, maybe I won't. And they're like, what, why? Because I just inherited 3 teenage and preteen boys, and these boys need a good male role model. And I can always make money. I got one chance to raise these boys into honorable men, and I'm not going to screw it up. So I retired, and I spent that next 8 years, I was their scoutmaster, raising them, took them to the butt, all that kind of stuff. So when they turned 18, they're moving on. I'm praying to God, what do you want me to do next? God, whatever it is, I'll do it. You lead, I'll follow. Be careful what you ask for. Because I came down to my office here, and I checked my computer, I checked my email. No big deal, right? I get this email. This is Metal Flowers Media Casting Company. We're casting a brand new television survival reality show, prime time on Fox, putting 10 of the top survival experts in the country against each other while dragging along a complete novice, somebody who's never even camped out in their backyard before, kicking and screaming. And we think you'd be great. Now, let me ask you, you get an email like that, what do you think? It's spam, right? It's a joke. I'm waiting for, and send $6,000 to Nigeria, right? It turned out to be real. I didn't want to do it. But you can't go, okay, well, God, not that, I said I'd do anything, but not that. So the next thing I know, I find myself on this reality show. Now, we're going to show clips for it from a second. I want to tell you something first, though. You'll see who they paired me up with. In fact, no, let's hold that. Let's go ahead and roll footage, and we can talk about it later. Here's some excerpts from Kicking and Screaming.
Chennai.
Please watch the champagne.
10 total divas are packing their bags for the adventure.
Welcome to the jungle.
Oh my God, you're doing
of a lifetime.
Oh, no.
They must survive a merciless jungle, paired with hardcore survivalists.
We even have the Boy Scouts of America.
Yeah! I don't only wear my Boy Scout uniform out here. I wear my Boy Scout uniform probably in my heart.
10 teams of total opposites battle.
And leading people who have no idea about anything.
For $500,000. It all starts now. Singing and screaming.
You are paired with your total opposite.
I'm the Boy Scout, and I play video games for a living.
Oh my God, it's a race. Oh my goodness. At the prize challenge, Jerry and Natalie collided.
This is helping. This is helping.
But they hugged it out in the elimination challenge. Boy Scout connects. Jerry and Natalie, you have won the challenge and will return to camp with ultimate power.
Woo! They're moving. No. Okay, they're both moving.
They're both moving.
I'm so sorry.
Just happened. Wow. Okay, let me see if I've got back. Am I back with y'all?
Just have to hit stop sharing and you'll be back with us all.
Okay, fantastic. All I see is share screen. I'm not seeing.
You're back.
Okay, I got you. Good. We're all back.
Okay, good, 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 good. Howdy. So that's Kicking and Screaming. And I gotta tell you something, though. Going in, and I knew this, I was the oldest competitor on the show. Okay? My wife was making fun of me. She's like, "Hi, you're the tog." Like, what's that? The token old guy. I mean, I'm that guy that's really cute that they've got that demographic. Well, he gonna die. And then representing all the Boy Scouts of America, I'm not that good. And yet, you know, again, it's really cute. They've got him on there. Looks cute in his neckerchief. He gonna die. But, you know, Scouts are more prepared. And again, it's not about your past and those things that would hold you back. It's about, okay, what do I need to do to prepare to get out there and try to win? And people ask me all the time about my competitor. I mean, they did good. They put opposites with each other, right? But that teaches a huge problem, two things. Number one, look for the good in people. It's in almost everybody. It's in there. And also, look for reasons to praise. I don't care who it is. You're at your business, in acting, your family, God with your family. Look for reasons to praise. Because I could have looked at, here we've got this pink and blue hair, fully tattooed up, tongue ring, atheist, online video gamer. Or I could look at, Natalie is smart. And she's funny. God, she's funny. And she is strong and competitive. And there's no way in the world that I could have won that show without Natalie. Look for the best in people and look for reasons to praise. Build people up. Don't tear them down, internet. What questions y'all have?
I mean, that's just really good words of wisdom, Terry, just in life in general. You know, I think too many of us, you know, will sometimes just see somebody and assume one thing. And I think, you know, I mean, that's what you've said there is something that really in our day-to-day lives that we can really, you know, keep in mind. I think we'll be all better people for doing that.
Yeah.
Any questions? Oh, here we go. Nope. Someone's just saying, love that. Optimism and appreciation, building others up. Yep, exactly, Hannah.
Thanks, Hannah. Well, you know, there's another story. Oh, Eric's got a question there. And then I've got another story that's helpful in the business context as well. This is another thing I teach around. So we'll go into that after Eric here.
On the TV show, I kind of like my best friend. It's kind of opposites in every single way. Like, that's kind of, I actually, like, we were, like, kind of enemies at first because we met each other at Philmont. He was an addition to our crew. I was new to the crew, and he was new to the crew, but we were, like, completely different, you know, and, like, religion was different. He was agnostic. I was a Christian. He was a Republican. I was a moderate, you know. It was a more Democrat. It was, everything was different, you know, all these things that you would think people look at and go, oh, I will only like people who are like me, this. But we found out that we have, like, the same, like, to the bottom line, morals. Like, we both, like, really accept the Scout Code. We accept this. And then we found out that if we look at things together from our, like, views, that we can really come up with some really great ideas. And we put away the whole idea of, oh, this person isn't like me, or this person doesn't have the same beliefs that are out there. Like, for example, like Democrat, Republican, they both want, hopefully everybody wants the same thing. They want this place to be better. They want everything to be better. So I don't think enough people realize that everybody's trying to do better. It's just people are more against each other than they are for themselves. I just wanted to say that because that was all on my mind, but thank you.
You got it. Yeah, focus on the similarities. It's too easy. We all have differences. We can all find something to pick apart with each other. Absolutely. Focus on the similarities. Focus on the things you can agree on. It's okay to talk about the other things in a respectful manner. Which brings us to, and then we'll go into some other questions, the fight. The fight that you saw. You saw Natalie and I get into it. Oh my gosh, international TV. And you know, as soon as that started, the cameras were right on us, man. That's good stuff right there. Now, understand, we were starving. I lost 25 pounds on this show. We are sleep deprived. We are under a lot of pressure, and we started going at it. Now, I actually learned this in scouting too, and I teach this to corporations. Stages of team development. There's four stages of team development. The first one is the forming stage. And that's where a team first gets together. Everything's going to be great. Oh, you're neat. I love you. No, I love you. You're fantastic. You're happens in marriages, a relationship. You're perfect. No, you're perfect, right? All that. It's going to be awesome. And then you come to the storming phase. That was forming, this honeymoon stage, then the storming stage. You realize you disagree on something. And yes, right. That's fighting it out, baby. Absolutely. And when we hit that, I realized what was going on. I said, okay, Natalie, hold on. We need to separate for a bit. And came back together. It's Natalie, got great news for you. We're storming. She was unimpressed. And no. It's okay. There's four stages of team development. Forming, storming, norming, and performing. Storming is a good thing. These are stages. They are stepping stones. They are not walls. You want to do that. If you stay in the honeymoon stage, you'll never get to performing. This is important for teams, that they know that storming is okay. It's all right to disagree if you do it with love and respect. Because after Natalie and I got through that fight, we got into that norming stage. You start working together some, start, okay, feeling each other out. You learn you've got each other's backs. Performing stage, after we fought, we became the most winning team on the entire show. The underdogs, the people, no, I asked the producer afterwards, you think I was gonna win? He said, nah. Stage of the team development is a big part of that. Back to you, Richard.
That's awesome. Dave O'Connor has one quick question regarding your scouting. He asks, what merit badge helped you best through life? And what was your Eagle Scout project on?
Man, tough question. You do these at Eagle Scout Board of Reviews, don't you? I'm going to say wilderness survival. And here's why. Wilderness survival teaches you that the most important, now people think, what's the most important aspect of survival? And this is important for everybody. Okay, is it water, food, shelter? What is it? None of those things. It's attitude. Attitude. Because you can have all the rest of those things. If you've got a bad attitude, if you are freaking out, looks like my yard people are here now. If you are freaking out, then you're going to die. All right? It doesn't matter. You're going to die. You got a bad attitude. You're going to die. That's all there is to it. All right? So it's all about having a great attitude. And you can survive through anything with a great attitude. Whew, I think I nailed that one. I feel good about that. Thanks.
Awesome. You know, that leaves us, Terry, with just a couple of minutes. I think it's a great opportunity for you to just to kind of maybe just do some closing comments for everyone.
Okay, fantastic. First of all, again, thank you for being here, listening in, everywhere you're listening in from. And it's the most important part of all this, and the thing I wanted you to come away from, my one thing, is that you have the power within you. Now, I know that this was built as public speaking, basically, and hopefully you learned some fantastic tips for public speaking. But that wasn't my main goal. My main goal was to help you use the power of the human voice, the power you possess, make a difference in the world, make the world a better place. You can do it. It's my hope that I was able to impart. So what was I thinking coming into this thing? I hope I do great, blah, blah, blah. No, no, no. It was my prayer, literally prayer before this, that I was able to impart something onto somebody here today where they'd look at that list of things that they made and they would do something with it, that they would make a difference in the world. If so, this time we spent together, oh my gosh, it was so worth it. So that's my departing thought to you. Make a difference in the world. Make the world a better place. Focus on the positives in people. They're in there. Most importantly, focus on the positives in yourself. Guys, thank you so much for your time. I really, really appreciate it.
Awesome message, Terry. And you know, just to give you some quick background too, you know, your message just resonates so much, I think, with May's Business School. Our mantra is very much discover, transform, impact. Our vision is advancing the world's prosperity. I mean, I think your message just hits so close to home and what we're trying to do and so forth. And I just look so forward to, like, once this whole thing is behind us, look so forward to getting you to College Station and getting you to be able to speak to everybody in person and finally get to shake your hand and take you to Dixie Chicken and all that kind of stuff. It's exciting and so grateful for you. Thank you so much. Really appreciate it.
You bet. Thank you, Richard. Thank you, Texas A&M University. Thank you all.
Have a great day. Talk soon.
Go get them, y'all.
Dig them.
Thank
you.
Thank you so much again.
You betcha.